Europe has a rich and deeply rooted religious heritage. Its unique buildings, tranquil spaces, and exquisite artifacts encompass the diversity of European culture and identity. This religious heritage is an invaluable resource that is handed over to us for all generations to enjoy. It is all around us and an integral part of our lives and communities. It includes rich cultural traditions, masterpieces of art, wonderful craftsmanship, and extraordinary music. In an era of globalization, cultural heritage helps us to remember our European cultural diversity, and its understanding develops mutual respect and contributes to dialogue amongst different cultures. The future of religious heritage presents us with challenges and opportunities. Knowledge transfer and innovation will be needed to hand over this remarkable patrimony to future generations. From the creative reuse of historic buildings to educational opportunities, from both real and virtual tourism to strengthening communities, the value of religious heritage is almost limitless. It is up to us to make the most of its potential. Since 2011, Future for Religious Heritage, a European network, has brought together charities, conservation experts, governmental, religious, and university institutions, as well as other professionals. FRH is a non-faith, not-for-profit organization that draws its strength from its diverse network. Our mission is to understand the challenges facing religious heritage, as well as the opportunities it presents to develop solutions for the 21st century. Our ambition is to maintain a network of European organizations with a strong structural framework for ongoing intercultural exchanges regarding the protection, conservation, and management of religious heritage. This network is open to you. Please join us now.
Dear conference participants, as President of Future for Religious Heritage, it is an honor to welcome you in FRH's 10th year anniversary to the second hybrid conference event, following the successful first event in Barcelona, Spain, on the continuity in function or use, in which members and non-members showed an active and lively participation in the chat. These hybrid events, a total of four, take place under the framework of the general conference theme, Europe's Living Religious Heritage, as part of the FRH EU Creative Europe project, Europe Connect. It is indeed a living heritage that consolidates the identity of Europe, and it is our task to perpetuate it amongst the citizenship. I am pleased to tell you that this new format is allowing so many people from all the corners of Europe and beyond to join in without traveling, that the number of registrations is again bigger than ever. Our organization has learned to adapt with the pandemics to the new circumstances. And as we announced before, we will keep this hybrid system as a permanent one. This way, we make sure all our members, without exception, will have the same chances to attend and participate despite travel costs or agenda conflicts. We are today the largest independent, non-faith, non-for-profit organization in Europe working to safeguard and protect religious buildings and their contents. We are more than 70 institutions and more than 100 professionals and experts from 38 countries and growing. FRH is the voice of religious heritage in Europe. As such, we are pleased many members enthusiastically join in the Ringing the Bells for Peace and Heritage on the 21st of September, sending their contribution of their religious buildings' bells ringing. Engaging and awareness raising are one of FRH aims. Therefore, I am very pleased to be able to share with you the latest developments of the Run for Heritage project, focusing this time especially on the young ones. Our next run will take place in Cantabria, at the very north of Spain, involving the rural schools of mountainous area of Picos de Europa, with children located in small isolated villages, and the main school students too in Potes, its rural capital. With great enthusiasm, the initiative was welcomed by the schools, and a total of 300 children will participate in the first run, which will end at the Monastery of Santo Toribio de Liébana. Now, a second run will take place in Orihuela, the cultural capital of the Costa Blanca at the Mediterranean, Spain, where around 1,000 children from different schools will proudly highlight the importance of their religious buildings. Being one of the schools located in a reused 16th century religious building as well, the former monastery of Santo Domingo. I am really looking forward to it and hope this initiative will inspire others to organize runs together with FRH. So please engage with the office if you are interested. On behalf of FRH, thank you very much to all of the participants and the schools who enthusiastically embraced the activity, together with the government of Cantabria and the municipality of Orihuela, of course. Now, this conference event we are about to start right now focuses on continuity in community and dialogue. The goal is clear: to learn from each other regarding maintenance and needs that circle around religious heritage. Dialogue with and within communities is essential. Communities are influential and important. They mirror various interest groups, from religious communities to monument preservation to tourists. All these communities shall be approached and involved as well. Management plans are necessary, vital I would say, to structure this involvement and also the continuity in communication. They could outline when and at which level of development, restoration and other measures a community will take an active role. A lively involvement of stakeholders helps in keeping heritage alive and discussions with multiple perspectives. Please note down, FRH has organized two more conference events scheduled, one in October the 22nd in Blankenberg and the final one in November in Brussels this year. This event is streaming live from the University of Bologna in Italy. Buon pomeriggio, Italia. Good afternoon, Italy. I would like to thank the participation and support of FRH member Luigi Bartolomei and the Centro Studi Cherubino Giardacci, the moderator Federica Fuligni, and the distinguished panelists, again, FRH member Luigi Bartolomei, FRH member Aldo Buzio from Craft Association, FRH member Antonia Gravagnolo from the Institute for Research on Innovation and Services for Development, and Teresa Carlone from the University of Bologna. I would also like to give special thanks to every member of Working Group B for its amazing preparatory work, as well as its coordinator and FRH member Suzanne Urban, for their amazing effort, inspiration, and commitment to the theme based on their input that gathers us together today. And again, patience, for their enormous flexibility to adapt constantly and repeatedly to the numerous changes in format over the past 1 year and a half. Dear all, I know religious heritage in Europe can count on you, and you can count on us, FRH, as your ambassadors. We all share the same aim. We want to save religious heritage, and we can only do it together. Thank you. I wish you all a great conference.
Thank you, Pilar, for your very kind and inspiring words on behalf of FRH. A warm welcome to all of you, audience, from wherever you are connected to this second event on living religious heritage. My name is Federica Fuligni. I am a PhD student at the Politecnico of Milano with a research topic on strategies for reuse processes on dismissed church systems. But today I'm here on behalf of Centro Studi Cherubino Girardacci, which is a member of FRH, and I have the honor of being your chair for today. We will have several international contributions that will fuel the debate on continuity in community, connection, and dialogue. Recorded video will take turns with a roundtable discussion with our panelists here at the University of Bologna. You are all invited to take part into the conversation by using the chat box you find there on the page. You may post questions or share your comments to be presented to the panelists. And the chat box will be moderated by FRH Executive Officer Jordi Malarac. So now let me introduce our panelists. Maybe we can start with Antonia, who is connected online.
Good afternoon, and thank you very much for this invitation. I thank the organization Future for Religious Heritage, of which I am a proud member. and also the Centro Studi Cherubino Gherardacci with Luigi Bartolomei and you, Federica. Thank you very much for this kind introduction. We are coming back from another conference of the Horizon 2020 CLIC project, EU-funded research that was just ended yesterday. So I'm very, very pleased to be here this afternoon with you to continue the discussion that we held in the last 2 days. And religious heritage was one of the key topics in the general context of the adaptive reuse of cultural heritage that has been the focus of our research for the last 3-4 years. So I'm very happy to be here to hear all the intervention, and I will try to give my contribution to this discussion. Thank you. We don't hear you.
Do you hear us now?
Can you hear us?
Okay, great.
Now? Great. Okay, so sorry if I'm like looking at that, and then I would like to look at the screen, but I will try to make this presentation as more comfortable for everybody. Good morning. I am Teresa Carlone. I am a research fellow at University of Bologna for the Department of Sociology and Economic Law. I'm here gently invited by Luigi, and I had pleasure to meet all the other panelists, and I'm sure this will be a very fruitful discussion. So my presence here is mostly to bring a point of view on community engagement, because my field of research is on that, on community engagement and co-design and co-creation processes in public and urban areas. I should confess, this is the first time I discuss and address about religious heritage, but I had the chance to already pre-watch the videos, and I learned a lot of stuff, and I got the chance to read and know about this topic. So I am open to discussion, and I'm very pleased to be here, and I hope I will give a fruitful contribution in discussion, and thank you everybody for being here.
Luigi.
Good afternoon, everybody, to all our audience. And thank you for participating in this conference organized at the University of Bologna by Centro Studi Cherubino Gherardacci, of which I'm now the president. I have also to say that Centro Studi Cherubino Gherardacci manage and somehow direct the journal, international journal IMBO, Ricerche e progetti per il territorio, la città e l'architettura. The second title is in Italian, but the journal is both in Italian and English. I mentioned this because it's quite relevant in relation to the topic we are on the table today, the relationship between community and religious space for a process of valorization and reuse. Since the last issue of our journal is exactly on this topic, the reuse and social reuse of a former monastery of cloistered nuns in Tuscany, in Lucca. And you can find this journal published on the platform ISU, and soon it will be published. So I think that our researchers, as Centro Studi Cherubino Gherardacci and also as Department of Architecture, are deeply focused on this topic of relationship between community and religious cultural heritage. So I am glad to add a part in the organization of this event in Bologna, for which I thank all the other presenters today. Thank you.
Okay, so I would give the word to Aldo Muzio.
Thank you very much. I will share some slides in order to introduce more than myself, my organization. I'm Aldo Muzio, legal representative of Associazione Craft, that is an Italian NGO, taking care about the reuse of a Baroque religious heritage building in Asti, in Piedmont. I will describe the relation between this building and the community, not only the religious community, but the community of the city, and the relation between the building and the cultural landscape of the city. The church, as you can see from the slide, has a longer period as a deconsecrated building than as an active spiritual church, because since the 19th century, the beginning of the 19th century, it was used for very civil, military, health, educational purposes, until the 70s, around which the church was converted into a sort of cultural space for exhibition, for let's say event and similar. The church belonged to the municipality of Asti, and in 2011 was reconverted into a theater. As you can see, is now a good and very fascinating mix of Baroque architecture with fresco and with a particular kind of conservation, together with the use as a contemporary theater, professional and dedicated to the national representation, and taking in the city of Asti shows and performances from all around Italy, and sometimes also from European countries. As a craft association, since 2016, we are managing this building with a specific purpose and an objective dedicated to the relation with the community of theater, the community of professional, the community of citizen, and so on. Very different communities, as maybe it was said in from other panelists in intervention. We work, first of all, in order to rehabilitate the identity of the church and to re-put the church in the center of the cultural landscape, because it was, since this long, very diverse use, was a sort of disappearance of the building into a very mixed urban landscape. In front of us, we have a parking spot, we have the courtyard in front, and so on. So it was not easy to be recognized as an active place, and for sure not as a cultural space. So we try to create into the community perception and identity for this place with different activity. Then, of course, we start with the creation of a new community. So in relation with the theme of this conference, is not only the continuity in community connection, but also the regeneration of a relation. We did it with different audience development strategies, but then in the evolving of time, we realized that this is not enough. And we start working in creating new community, first of all, professional community, the international community of FRH, the local community of cultural profession of ADA, but also connection with the community of young, of childs, and so on. Right now in Asti, a course, a seminar about architecture for kids is going on, and little kids are exploring the space and understanding what is architecture in this very particular kind of building. Nowadays, we are working on a very different challenge. We see that with the pandemic, with the lockdown, and so on, the connection with the community was completely broke down. And so now our goal is in particular to recreate a connection that of course for some months moved on Zoom, as you can see on the left, but now is coming back. Due to the limitation, the space is no more valuable for 150 people, but for no more than 50. So we are looking for something that cannot count on numbers, on quantity of people, but on quality of relation. So what we are building with the community is a deep and fruitful relation from both sides, looking especially on the people, the part of the community who suffer more from that strange period. And we say that young and let's say student under 25 particularly suffer. And so we are starting back from them in order to recreate a new and strange relation with this community. Thank you very much.
Okay, great. Thank you. Thank you very much, Aldo, for this first example on continuity and community. That was already very interesting. And thank you to the panelists to present themselves. Now we can move on. We can start with our first intervention. This is prepared by a working group on community and dialogue. The working group was made by different experts on religious heritage, and the work is being presented today by Suzanne Urban, who is the coordinator of Working Group B, and by Caterina Ruscio, who is a member of the working group. Caterina is an archaeologist and lecturer of early Christian art in the American University of Rome. She is a PhD candidate at the University of Malta at the Faculty for the Built Environment, and her research focuses management of tourism on religious sites. Suzanne Urban started dealing with religious and above all Jewish heritage in the 90s. In 1994, she worked in the Jewish Museum and in a Jewish journal in Frankfurt. And in 2004, she was a fellow researcher at the Yad Vashem and afterwards employed in Yad Vashem as well, the main center for remembrance of the Shoah in Israel. Since November 2015, she is managing director for the Association of Sham Cities and its Jewish heritage Inspire Worms and Minds, which is a member of the FRH. She lectures and publishes on Jewish heritage sites and how these places are today maintained, cared about, and managed. The presentation will be immediately followed by Valerio Pennasso, director of the National Office of Italian Bishops Conference for ecclesiastical culture, heritage, and religious buildings. He will share with us the experience of CLI Lab. As we will see, this were the occasion to include community participation into the building process of new religious spaces. And the introduction by Valerio Pennasso will be followed by some insights from the architect Alessandro Bellini, who was part of the expert team leading the dialogue with the community. We will then hear Francesca Gianni reflecting on religious heritage as common good and its possible reuse for social purposes. Francesca is an architect and she holds a PhD in architecture from the University La Sapienza in Rome. Her research is on ecclesiastical buildings between social valorization and adaptive reuse about Italian convents. She works with the Italian church and she also teaches management of ecclesiastical buildings. To conclude the first video session, Davide Di Modugno will take us through the legal framework in which ecclesial buildings are defined, and he will also offer us some first study cases about future perspective for dismissed heritage. Davide is a PhD candidate in law and institutions at the University of Turin Law Department, with a research project concerning a special category of cultural heritage, places of worship, so reuse and management in comparative perspective. Okay, so just a very quick reminder, before starting, you may use the chat at any moment to share your comments and to post questions. So thank you and enjoy this first video session.
A community is crucial for safeguarding tangible and intangible religious cultural heritage.
And the document drawn up by our group highlighted the important aspects of the role of communities in managing cultural, religious cultural heritage. And we actually found out many interesting things through the case studies we discussed about and analyzed. A community might be defined as a social unit with commonality, such as norms, religion, values, customs, professional regions, and territories. What is the central in communities, the sense of belonging? Actually, Richard Millington defines five types of different communities: interest communities, action communities, place communities, pride, practice communities, and circumstance communities. Interest communities are the communities of people who share the same interest and passion. Action communities are those communities of people trying to bring about change. Place communities are communities of people brought together by geographic boundaries. Practice communities are communities of people in the same profession. Circumstance communities are communities of people brought together by external events or situation. A highly significant aspect brought to light during our discussion is also the variety of communities involved in culture, in religious cultural heritage. There are religious entities, monument preservation, city, regional, state administration, local communities, church, border, pastor, workers, tourists, heritage group, genealogical interest groups, tour operators and guides, local, regional, and national trust. Communities play an important role in preservation, interpretation, and displaying of meanings of heritage. The FARO Convention indicates the decision of community to pass on cultural heritage to future generation and to do so in the framework of public action. Also, UNESCO recognizes the great value of religious cultural heritage by declaring that understanding the continuing nature of religious and sacred heritage, having the capacity to protect its authenticity and integrity, and sharing the knowledge of our common history, are the three important pillars necessary for building mutual respect and dialogue between communities. What we found very relevant during our discussion is looking at the case studies, as I said at the beginning. One essential aspect is the participation, the participatory process. So involving people in the creation of a strategy, as we could see, for example, in one of the case studies of the Flanders or the case of the 45 churches of Transylvania. As the last thing, we actually looked at the communities dealing with religious heritage that has very often experienced conflicts, such as the relationship between the local communities and the community of tourists, particularly in places where there is this big problem of mass tourism and religious sites. What is essential is drafting guidelines and principles of common respect that are the basis of good management for leading religious heritage sites. Sort of educate the visitors to respect the differences and tradition and be part of the religious cultural heritage life.
Yeah, the working group on community and dialogue of living heritage, it was very interesting to have various perspectives on this topic. And what we found out somehow is also about communities' involvement is important not to work only on something or with some place and space, but to integrate the people. And there, as Katharina said, and sum it up, it is also about community involvement and of community varieties. So it's not only a dialogue, but it's also identities of various groups and communities. And I want to give a small example on the Jewish compound in Worms, which is now UNESCO World Heritage. And this Jewish compound in Worms, it consists of a synagogue, a ritual bath, and a synagogue garden. And it was rebuilt after the Holocaust, and there was no Jewish community in Worms itself, but it is owned, the whole compound, by the Jewish community in Mainz. And they had no resources up to today with personal resources, financial resources, to maintain and to care for this compound. And so there is a trustee contract with the city of Worms. And this is somehow the first community involved into this. So it's more the political and administrational and municipal level. And then you have for sure the ownership. It's a Jewish community with its own needs and ideas and perspectives. And you have the religious lost the halacha, and you have tourists, and you have Jewish groups, and you have monuments preservationists, so you have many, many groups, and it's interesting that since many years, they developed also, because they have to work together, many different communities, they have to stay in dialogue, and they have also to develop somehow like not only sensitivities for each other and for the demands, but they also have to learn to have a real debate about things. So if you want to care for the monument, can you close it because it is visited by many tourists and it's also needed for the community for some services. So you have to find solutions and also to work on compromises. So it's I think it's really somehow like a best practice. And you also need some organized community dialogue. So like a managing board or a scientific board. And you also have to know when to involve which community and which experts and when to involve the religious experts, just to have a real strategy about around all these monuments and about around this religious heritage. And it's also important to have inner perspectives if you talk about education on religious heritage. And I think that's not only if you look at the compound in Worms or and some other Jewish heritage, but you have also to educate about the spirit of a religious heritage. It must not be orthodox or something, but you have to somehow like mediate this religious spirit if you educate about around it. So I think this is something important, and now I want to get again more general. I think it's also very important if you deal with religious heritage and communities that it's not taken over by some political interests, because also there is a community. And if you have somehow like political shifts or something, sometimes it's used, religious heritage it's used for politicians' decisions or to make some decisions more glamorous or something. And so it's also important to have a community who's caring about this, but that it's taken over by some specific interests. So this is also something that communities shall be in a dialogue to have the authenticity of a religious heritage, not somehow like broken, or that people develop there something against this. And now to come more again into the focus of the religious Jewish heritage, I think communities need to be aware of this very fragile situation often around Jewish heritage. It's part of European heritage, and it's very diverse in form, meaning, and also faces often many existential problems, as we see in Worms, when the communities have no means to maintain and care. And so you need to be involved. You need to involve many communities. You need this community dialogue. You need really a dialogue, not a monologue. And so you can take charters and declarations as one foil, but you need to have the real life and the real managing board, and to develop there something adapted or adopted by the reality around these religious heritages, to have activities on these religious heritage and also here on the Jewish heritage unfold. So a dialogue between and within communities is or shall be guaranteed, and then heritage, in my opinion, can be managed really adequately.
L'Ufficio Nazionale per i Beni Culturali Ecclesiastici e l'Edilizia di Culto della Conferenza Episcopale Italiana si occupano da decenni della realizzazione, attraverso i fondi dell'8 per 1000, di nuove chiese e di restauro delle chiese esistenti per le comunità. Questo legame profondo tra la Conferenza Episcopale Italiana, cioè i vescovi italiani, e le comunità non soltanto diocesane, ma delle singole parrocchie, dei paesi, delle realtà anche più marginali delle città, piuttosto che delle aree interne dell'Italia, ha sempre tenuto conto, da una parte, le attenzioni e quelle che sono le problematiche legate alla comunità, e dall'altra la qualificazione dei professionisti e delle modalità con le quali si arriva alla progettazione di interventi di restauro e di conservazione e anche di nuova realizzazione. La collaborazione profonda tra la Conferenza Episcopale Italiana e il Monastero di Bose fin dal 2003 sui temi dell'adeguamento liturgico, ma anche sui temi importanti dei luoghi delle celebrazioni, quindi anche della costruzione di nuove chiese, ha condotto a far sì che i convegni nazionali, internazionali di liturgia, che proprio dal 2003 si realizzano a Bose, potessero arrivare alla maturazione di nuove procedure laboratoriali per far sì che il legame già esistente potesse ulteriormente approfondirsi. Già negli ultimi 10 anni l'ufficio per la nuova edilizia di culto aveva attivato modalità partecipative da parte delle comunità nella redazione di quelli che sono i documenti fondamentali di indirizzo per i progettisti in ordine alla realizzazione di concorsi nazionali e internazionali per la costruzione di nuove chiese. Ma proprio negli anni 2017-2018 si è cercato di collegare maggiormente la progettazione alle necessità proprie delle comunità e delle persone, comunità non soltanto religiose, ma le comunità dei nostri paesi e delle nostre città, laddove anche ci siano esperienze anche di scarso interesse nei confronti della Chiesa. L'assunto principale che nasceva nella costituzione di un laboratorio, convegni di liturgia internazionale, CLI, attività di laboratorio, CLI Lab, l'assunto principale di queste, nella costituzione di questo laboratorio è stato quello di verificare se il lavoro comunitario, comune tra diverse professionalità, architetti, ingegneri, storici dell'arte, artisti, sociologi, cultori più diversi delle conoscenze umane, potessero essere di aiuto nella stesura delle linee proprie che sarebbero state utilizzate poi per la progettazione. La verifica, ovvero, che i gruppi di progettazione misti e articolati nei bandi di concorso che ormai si realizzano attivando proprio le professionalità che ho detto, potevano essere supportati da delle attività previe adeguate perché potessero essere comprese le diverse necessità. E così è stato. Nel 2017 si sono attivati 4 gruppi. Nelle diocesi di Altamura, Gravina, Acquaviva delle Fonti, a Oppido, Mamertina, Palmi, a Catanzaro, Squillace e a Monreale, gruppi formati da giovani e hanno verificato come la necessità di coinvolgere le persone sia diventata quella di maggiore esigenza, la necessità di intervenire affinché le persone potessero dare la propria voce, le proprie necessità, le proprie esperienze, in modo tale che la comunità diventasse non soltanto più destinataria nella costruzione di una chiesa, ma diventasse una comunità esigente, una comunità che sa quel che desidera perché ha delle necessità, le esprime, una comunità che è cresciuta e cresce nell'ordine proprio delle diverse tematiche, quella liturgica, quella sociale, quella architettonica, quella artistica. Un percorso che nel tempo si è strutturato attraverso dei veri e propri programmi, dei veri e propri contratti anche. Ci sono degli animatori delle attività partecipative che collaborano direttamente con la diocesi di riferimento, che vanno a redigere dei programmi, delle finalità, degli obiettivi, a raccogliere tutte le informazioni attraverso delle attività di partecipazione per poterle restituire alla comunità parrocchiale di riferimento oppure alla diocesi stessa, che è la committente principale. Tutte queste attività sono raccolte sul sito dell'Ufficio Nazionale per i Beni Culturali e l'Edilizia di Culto, bce.chiesacattolica.it, nella sezione dei concorsi, e costituiscono la base fondamentale sulla quale poi il Vescovo e i suoi organismi diocesani e parrocchiali di partecipazione e di condivisione redigono lo strumento per la progettazione preliminare. E questo strumento che servirà poi per l'indizione di un bando internazionale al quale possono partecipare dei gruppi di progettazione formati proprio da architetti, ingegneri di varia tipologia e professionalità, artisti e liturgisti. Si tratta di un vero processo di partecipazione, un processo che tiene conto della diversificazione a livello comunitario delle diverse responsabilità, ma che parte proprio dal basso in una forma sinodale che cerca di restituire alla comunità un prodotto architettonico, un prodotto che possa rispondere alle necessità di quella comunità in quel luogo.
Buongiorno a tutti, oggi relazionerò circa alcune esperienze di partecipazione nell'iter di progettazione di nuovi complessi parrocchiali. La progettazione e realizzazione di un nuovo complesso parrocchiale richiede competenze tecniche, ma anche di forte specialismo nella liturgia, nelle esigenze di catechesi, carità, socializzazione delle comunità cristiane, oltre che rapportarsi con altre figure, quali artisti, liturgisti e altri specialisti. Per affrontare tale pluralità di competenze, nell'ambito dei convegni liturgici internazionali CLI, è stata promossa un'iniziativa finalizzata alla sperimentazione dell'intreccio tra competenze liturgiche e metodi di promozione della progettazione partecipata comunitaria, denominati CLILAB, come già anticipato da Don Valerio Penasso. Obiettivo prioritario del CLILAB, prima ancora di risolvere i singoli problemi delle parrocchie e diocesi coinvolte, è stata la definizione di un metodo di lavoro. Metodo poi affinato e ripreso per i percorsi di partecipazione promossi dall'Ufficio Nazionale BCE e della CEI, che dal 2019 sono stati istituiti per fornire alle comunità e alle diocesi strumenti utili alla costruzione di un progetto condiviso. Queste analisi, scambi e raccolte di dati avranno poi una ricaduta pratica in quanto confluiranno nel DPP, documento preliminare alla progettazione, che fungerà da guida e indirizzo per i gruppi di lavoro nella fase di concorso. Qui sono indicate le 5 fasi di cui il processo partecipato si compone. Sono da intendersi come traccia, in quanto le esperienze proposte possono coinvolgere anche più di una fase. Nella prima fase, accogliere e programmare, oltre alla definizione del piano programmatico condiviso mostrato in precedenza, hanno luogo una serie di primi incontri, occasione di condivisione con la comunità ospitante. Oltre a accogliere, si risulta sempre accolti. La presenza di un soggetto esterno garantisce una terzietà e non implicazione dell'osservatore, che al contempo funge anche da garante e mediatore. In questa fase ci sono normalmente i primi spunti, si iniziano ad individuare bisogni e necessità e vedere quali sono gli attori da coinvolgere nel processo, oltre a una prima osservazione della comunità e del territorio e il reperimento di alcuni dati e documenti. Si è andati anche a rilevare l'elenco degli stakeholder, di restituire una mappatura di forza su parametri quali il potere economico, il potere decisionale e la distanza del luogo dell'intervento. Per il percorso di Simeri Mare, il team incaricato ha restituito e condiviso con la comunità di Simeri una rappresentazione multiforme del paesaggio, fotografica, testuale, grafica e sonora. Nella fase incontrare e ascoltare, una serie di incontri e dialoghi ha permesso di iniziare a conoscere la comunità sia a livello demografico, sia di mappare delle parole chiave emerse dai dialoghi circa l'idea del sacro per la comunità. In prima istanza, per Giavere, è emersa l'importanza della sacralità del verde, oltre al parco campetto dell'oratorio. Circa le criticità, è emersa la paura riguardo ai costi dell'operazione a carico della parrocchia, del dimensionamento dei vari spazi e della loro sicurezza. Obiettivo di questi percorsi è anche quello di superare per i dimensionamenti le vecchie tabelle, ma di entrare più nello specifico dei bisogni, dare una quantificazione su essi, chiesa ed eventuale cappella feriale, ma anche opere parrocchiali, salone e casa canonica. Nella fase comunicare e informare, la partecipazione implica un coinvolgimento propositivo della comunità, ma è altresì vero che spesso le comunità non possiedono strumenti critici necessari a sviluppare processi partecipati consapevoli. La fase comunicare e informare prevede dei momenti formativi ed è occasione del percorso partecipato non solo per accrescere le competenze sui temi dell'architettura, arte e liturgia, ma anche arricchire di nuovi contenuti il percorso partecipativo stesso. Questo è un momento di formazione a distanza durante il CLILAB a Simerimare. Per il percorso di Giavre di Montello sono stati somministrati dei questionari durante gli incontri formativi per cercare di mappare una sensibilità della popolazione circa i temi trattati riguardanti architettura, liturgia e arte. Oltre che aver previsto un maggior numero di incontri in presenza nonostante le restrizioni legate alla pandemia del Covid. Questi percorsi hanno quindi dei gradi di resilienza, ad esempio un viaggio previsto per visitare complessi parrocchiali contemporanei nelle vicinanze è stato ricalibrato con un viaggio virtuale che ha visto la presenza e partecipazione dei sacerdoti che vivono quegli spazi per raccontarli. Sperimentare e partecipare. È importante riuscire a coinvolgere le fasce deboli, ovvero quelle che normalmente non trovano spazio nei processi decisionali, ovvero anziani e bambini. Un'attenzione particolare è stata data a questi ultimi. All'inizio ai ragazzi è stato chiesto cosa colpisce loro del paesaggio che normalmente vedono per raggiungere la chiesa o dei luoghi per loro significativi e creare una mappa schematica di post-it condivisa. Hanno rappresentato poi il loro percorso casa rotorio, un primo laboratorio per capire e scoprire il loro immaginario rispetto al nucleo abitato, che vivono o che sono solite esperienziare. Studiare i loro percorsi di ritualità ed individuare quelle presenze urbane che suscitano maggiormente la loro attenzione. Con la collaborazione della fotografa Cristina Bolzanello sono state predisposte le carte d'identità dei ragazzi, nelle quali raccogliere, oltre ai dati oggettivi quali l'età, anche altre informazioni. Ad esempio il colore preferito emerso è stato il verde, che ha trovato corrispondenza con la sacralità per loro della natura. Il laboratorio è continuato con l'attività La Chiesa che vorrei, dove è stato chiesto ai ragazzi di rappresentare il centro parrocchiale con la chiesa dei loro sogni. L'utilizzo del disegno, soprattutto con i bambini, non serve tanto per raccogliere spunti progettuali e formali, ma per vedere i loro stati d'animo, le loro aspettative ed immaginari. Nella fase finale, quella di sintetizzare e consegnare, durante questi percorsi ci si trova spesso con una gran mole di materiale da dover poi ordinare, sintetizzare e riportare in una forma grafica. In questo caso si è cercato di dare immediatezza del sesso di chi partecipa, della sua provenienza, anche in relazione alla distanza, in una forma grafica facilmente visualizzabile. In questo altro esempio si mostra una linea rossa che è quella rappresentata del confine comunale, quella gialla invece indica l'estensione della partecipazione reale alla vita della comunità. I luoghi di culto nelle vicinanze, quelli che la comunità normalmente fruisce, sono stati raccolti e tradotti anche ai desiderata dei ragazzi. Le preferenze sui temi dell'architettura e dell'arte nei momenti di formazione attraverso la somministrazione di questionari relativi all'attività formativa proposta. Alla fine del percorso, nel caso di Giavre, in occasione della festa della celebrazione della Santa Messa per i Santi Giacomo e Cristoforo, Santi Patroni, è stata allestita una mostra con gli esiti del percorso partecipato. La presentazione del percorso si è tenuta prima della celebrazione della Santa Messa, che ha visto coinvolti Don Valerio Penasso in rappresentanza della CEI, Sua Eminenza Reverendo Monsignor Tommasi, Vescovo di Giavra, oltre a Monsignor Mauro Motterlini, incaricato diocesano per l'edilizia di culto, e il parroco di Giavra. La partecipazione al fare comunità della Chiesa, non solo quella locale ma a tutti i livelli, la forza e il senso di vicinanza, oltre ad aiutare a trascendere dai soli bisogni particolari, ma fa sì che il traguardo sia un orizzonte comune. I documenti prodotti convergeranno poi nel DPP, documento preliminare alla progettazione. Il futuro della comunità è consegnato nelle sue stesse mani, in un percorso di crescita e responsabilizzazione, ognuno rispetto ai propri ruoli. L'auspicio è che partecipare possa aumentare sia il senso di appartenenza, sia la capacità della comunità di prendersi cura dei nuovi luoghi, diventando soggetto proponente attivo di una partecipazione anche futura al compimento del percorso partecipato. Vi ringrazio per l'attenzione.
Buongiorno, sono Francesca Giani, architetto con un dottorato di ricerca in ingegneria dell'architettura sul tema del riuso adattivo e della valorizzazione a fini sociali degli immobili ecclesiastici, con un focus sui conventi italiani, quindi sul riuso dei conventi a scopi sociali. Mi è stato chiesto di parlare sul tema del riuso soprattutto in relazione alla comunità circostante. Affronterò i seguenti temi: quali sono i beni ecclesiastici, le caratteristiche intrinseche di questi beni e il bene comune, per poi affrontare alcuni esempi. Gli immobili ecclesiastici sono beni mixtifori, ovvero sottoposti a un duplice regime giuridico, civile e canonico. Mentre la legge civile equipara i beni ecclesiastici per lo più a beni privati, il diritto canonico li scrive nei beni pubblici e ne subordina l'esistenza all'asservimento dei fini della Chiesa cattolica. Oltre alle indicazioni del CIC dei beni immobili ecclesiastici come beni pubblici, esiste già una relazione spesso molto forte tra la comunità circostante e gli immobili ecclesiastici, dove la comunità spesso ha supportato sia economicamente che nella manutenzione gli immobili e identificandosi con gli stessi. Ad esempio, sono a Ruota, un piccolo borgo in comune di Capannori, dove ancora oggi i 200 abitanti partecipano in modo attivo nella manutenzione e nel dare i proventi per pagare le utenze e la manutenzione della chiesa. Ma esiste un ulteriore legame tra la comunità e i beni della chiesa, che appunto sono subordinati alle finalità della chiesa stessa. Per dimostrarlo mi avvalgo della formula dell'Istituto della Compagnia di Gesù, in particolare rimarcando la differenza tra la prima formula approvata da Paolo III nel 1540 e quella definitiva approvata da Papa Giulio III il 21 luglio del 1550. Si introduce all'interno della formula che descrive la vita che ogni gesuita vuole abbracciare una serie di opere, e tutte quelle vengono descritte sembreranno utili alla gloria di Dio e al bene comune. La locuzione bene comune viene appunto introdotta dopo 10 anni e risuona ben 2 volte all'interno della formula dell'istituto. Quindi è come se si prendesse coscienza che la gloria stessa di Dio è vivibile anche attraverso la costruzione del bene comune. Ed è per questo, appunto, che i beni della Chiesa, anche quelli di culto, fatti salvi quelli invece edificati per il sostentamento del clero, hanno comunque intrinsecamente una vocazione al bene comune.
Mentre iniziano a scorrere delle immagini di buone pratiche, di condivisione di orti o giardini, di conventi con la comunità circostante, è bene precisare che l'obiettivo della valorizzazione dei beni immobili ecclesiastici non può essere quello della massimizzazione del profitto, ma della valorizzazione dei beni immateriali intrinseci alle finalità del patrimonio ecclesiastico, nel rispetto della sostenibilità architettonica, ambientale, economica e finanziaria, ecclesiale, spirituale, legale, sociale e umana a valere nel tempo, e nel rispetto dell'ecologia integrale della transizione ecologica caro a Papa Francesco. Passiamo all'esempio del monastero di Tonadico sulle Dolomiti, in cui i frati francescani hanno lasciato il loro immobile a una comunità di monache di clausura, quindi un riuso all'interno della stessa comunità religiosa, per poi passare all'esperienza dell'accoglienza pellegrina di Pietrasanta, che ha visto il convento di San Francesco parzialmente utilizzato per ospitare i pellegrini della Via Francigena, esperienza già praticata da oltre 20 anni nella canonica di Valpromaro, piccolissimo borgo alle porte di Lucca, dove passò anche Sigerico e dove oggi sono accolti ormai da 20 anni gratuitamente i pellegrini della Francigena verso Lucca. Concludo auspicando il riuso degli immobili ecclesiastici al fine di incrementare il bene comune per la maggior gloria di Dio, come sembra ricordare la pala d'altare presente nella chiesa di Ruota.
Good afternoon. My name is Davide Di Modugno, and I am a PhD candidate in Law and Institutions at the Law Department of the University of Turin. Today, I would like to present you some aspects of my thesis concerning the reuse of places of worship in a comparative perspective. In particular, I will focus on ecclesiastical, cultural heritage and new strategies of community participation for its reuse in Italy. First of all, I am going to provide you a definition of ecclesiastical goods. Secondly, we will see how the principle of subsidiarity and the notion of common goods are intended both in the Italian juridical debate and in the magisterium of the Catholic Church. After that, I will show you some interesting cases in Italy in which the participation of the community plays a key role. And finally, I will draw my conclusions. Ecclesiastical goods are goods owned by a public juridic person according to the Code of Canon Law. They are finalized to three specific purposes: worship, support to the clergy, and charity. When they use for worship ends, we should find new profane uses that are compatible with the two other finalizations, in particular with charity. Another important element that we should keep in mind is the distinction between hierarchical church and religious communities. Hierarchical church can be represented as a pyramidal structure with at the top the Holy See, then the Italian Episcopal Conference, diocese, and at the bottom parishes. While religious communities are completely independent one from the other, also on the economic side, they own monasteries and convents, and they do not benefit from the 8 per mille mechanism, that is the mechanism by which Italian taxpayers can contribute to religious organizations. So, for all these reasons, this heritage is the most at risk. An international conference, Charism and Creativity, will be held in Rome next year on the 4th and on the 5th May 2022. Moving to the notion of common goods, we should start from the definition provided by Rodotà Commission, according to which common goods are goods that express functional utilities for the exercise of fundamental rights and the free development of the individual. In the following simplification, cultural goods are included. Related to the notion of common goods, there are the principle of subsidiarity and the social function of property, both recognized by the Italian Constitution. Another important element that I want to point out is the bionivocal influence between culture and religious, because culture can contribute to create religion, but also religion can influence the culture in a specific territory, the so-called enculturation of the Catholic Church in a community. Both the principle of subsidiarity and the social function of property are recognized by the constant magisterium of the Church. More recently, Pope Francis stated that the Church must not occupy spaces, but activate processes. And in these processes, we have to involve not only the community of believers, but the whole civil society. Some problems arise. Firstly, secularization can determine a contraction of the community of believers, but also the decrease in the number of priests and religious people. According to an authoritative study, if trends don't change, all the Italian convents will be closed by 2046. Finally, demographic decline and the movement of people from rural areas to metropolitan areas can lead these assets to neglect and abandonment. So, a solution could be found in the adaptive reuse of churches, oratories, chapels, monasteries, and convents. In all these processes, the participation of the community plays a fundamental role, as I will show you in the following cases. In the case of the Golden Cross Church in Rivoli, a collaboration pact was signed between the municipality that owns the building and an association of citizens that manage this good for liturgical activities. but the same legal instrument can be used when we find a new profane use. In the case of San Remigio Church in Carignano, the ownership is on the municipality, but we have there a private association of citizens that are taking account of the refurbishment work. Another very interesting case is the case of the former monastery in Vico Pelago, Lucca, in Tuscany. There, a summer school was organized by the University of Bologna in the person of Professor Luigi Bartolomei, and this was a great opportunity for stakeholders to convey their interest in the reuse of this building. But the crucial element of this project is the idea to re-propose the elements of democracy of monastic chapter into the new legal instruments. The solution of the foundation of participation has been taken into consideration. Moving to Emilia-Romagna in Faenza, we have the case of the former Salesian house that was bought by a joint stock company, Faventia Sales SPA, that was established by municipality, diocese and bank foundation. And this impressive building is used both for public and private activities. Finally, we have the case of Reggio Città Universitaria Committee, a formally recognized committee created by the diocese and public and private partners with the aim to transform the former seminary of Reggio Emilia into a new university campus. In conclusion, I want to point out three elements: the research of new legal instruments for innovative reuse solutions, then the importance of participation of the community both at the ecclesiastical level and at the civil society level, because all in this way we can try to transform a potential border into a great opportunity for the cultural, social and economic development of local communities. Thank you very much for your attention.
All right, so thanks to all the video contributors. I think their presentation brought us right in the middle of the topic. We have heard many words popping up. We've heard community, dialogue, integration needs. So perhaps we could start reflecting on which is the boundary of the community. So who shall the process involve? How, which are the strategies? There is a, perhaps you want to tell us something about community engagement and.
Yeah. How much time do you have? Do I have to
about
do that?
5 minutes.
So okay. Yeah, that's cool. So if you can,
I'm here.
Yeah, yeah, give me signs when my time is almost done. Yeah, those are very interesting experience of community engagement, and of course we can see the involvement and participation of community throughout all the process of reshaping spaces and project and make a proposal project to rebuild or renew spaces, and specifically religious spaces. I use the word spaces to, and I refer to open spaces and closed spaces, so buildings and open spaces. But what I would like to focus on is the concept of community, since I'm not very expert in this specific topic, but I do deal a little bit with community, because we used to tend to consider and define community as a monolithic category, while it's a very heterogeneous group of people inside. And there is a video that shows how mapping the community and the stakeholder involved in this project is essential in order to understand the interest and the power of those people in terms of how they can contribute and participate in the process. And when I think that those two words, the power and their interest, are crucial in this project, because power, and by power, which is a word but that mostly is surrounded by negative meaning, we should redefine the meaning of this word, because community have power over places, meaning power to act, because they shape places, and they have a say on this, the public space that community use, and how the community identify itself in the space and give shape to the space. And power, it's mostly because specifically in those projects you give community, like this project gave community an active part in the decision. So that's a matter of power, which is a very potential tool in the hand of those who are interested in these regeneration processes. And interest, this is another topic, and I think it's extremely important, because specifically for religious buildings and spaces, the sense of identity, the owning of the space, the sense of belonging, and the historical bonds that they have with this with these spaces, it's crucial, and it cannot not take it into consideration when you when the project a regenerative project is implemented. And but how, so given this heterogeneous composition of the communities, how we do organize community? And there is this specific activity which is called community organizing, that it opens up to what it's called participatory process, because those are participatory process, because people are asked to be part of a decision with different intensity, of course, because some decisions are already made or cannot be made by communities. But I think that starting from the community organizing activity, it's important because it builds relations, and it's specifically with some critical aspect that Davide in the last presentation pointed out, reinforce and restable and make more stable relations. It's important in order to make people feeling that they have responsibility over a place. And this is a dynamics that it's also used or facilitate in public space regeneration process. And I think it's more important in those processes. So the fact that there is a community then and relationships within this community, it's extremely important. And community organizing also can give and can activate internal resources that we cannot, for example, we not foreseen in the project. If you deal with community, and if you interact, and if you activate community, you can find a huge amount of resources, which are competencies, which are capabilities, which are interests, of course. And community, of course, help out in the problem assessment and in the process of problem solving. So given that the fact that we are dealing with this specific heritage and with the specific buildings and value, which is value, it's a concrete, it's a material value, but it's also symbolic value, it's extremely important to involve the community. So why involved? As I said, to share responsibility, to increase the sense of ownership, and to give the voice to those who are constantly excluded. A presentation here mentioned the most vulnerable, and we used to think that the most vulnerable are just young and old people, but a lot of people are more vulnerable and constantly excluded by the process, like migrants, for example, like marginalized people, which are one of the most important targets of the church, for example, for the Catholic and church. Those are one of the main attentions. So why do not involve them also in this decision process, and how they can shape and can redefine the meaning and the use of those religious heritage. And last, I will go into conclusion, and involving community and engage them also help in compose the conflict that has been said at the beginning of the presentation, and not avoiding it. There is different layers of conflict related to religious heritage, and avoiding it or not recognize the conflict do not allow and make those spaces accessible for tourists, for people, for believers. And yet, if you start a process and open up to process of community building and to participatory processes, you can deal with the conflict in terms of making a collaborative and shared decision instead of and also to collaboratively define the governance of those places, because they attract different people. So it's extremely important to keep these spaces as much open as possible, and given also the value, the cultural value. So I think the community engagement could help out with this aspect also.
Yes, sure it does. And also these different levels of accessibility, and they emphasize that religious buildings and religious heritage is part of our everyday environment, and they are also common goods despite of the faith of people and the surroundings. And I think that, as you were saying, community may be very various, and so it's the expertise that are needed to work with the community and also to develop some effective strategies. So I don't know, Luigi, if you want to add up on this.
I was thinking in relation to communities that we saw different cases study in this case, but in we saw active churches still used for worship and rituals. And of course, in that case, the involvement of the community is as also a symbolical meeting meaning, since indeed the community is the one who celebrates, and so. But in those cases, Valerio Pennasso exhibit the the new evolution of the Catholic Church itself, which for which now the involvement of the people, it's a goal in their use. But we have also the cases, and they are the most part of them, where the churches have lost this use, or is just residual. So we we have a few celebrations during the year, and so underused churches, underused based. And in that case, probably the community we should take into account it even wider, not because it's not wide enough when we take into account parishes, but in those cases we have a sense of deeper attachment from the ones who are church goers rather than from the ones who are not. Instead, for dismissed churches in all Europe, but especially here in Italy, where the density of these buildings is enormous, or even bigger than in other European regions, we should introduce the possibility that churches could become a sort of infrastructure for reactivate the community themselves, where we have a kind of losing of inhabitants. I'm speaking about the countryside, and especially here in Bologna, for example, for the audience, which is far, we have the Apennines on our shoulder here, and the Apennines keep on losing inhabitants and people because of the lack of services and facilities for inhabitants. Why don't use the churches as infrastructure to provide not only services, but place where to build the community itself, but occasions to create this community again. And I'm going to my conclusion. When you touch a church even if it's dismissed or even if it's closed, often churches are made to be visible. They gain this goal by means of different characteristics. The point of view of landscape, for example, sometimes they are really, really visible. And some other, they are really well made. I mean, sometimes it's even the characteristic of the building itself, which create a sense of attachment. Because in some little villages where there is nothing else than the church, good looking and even attractive from the way in which it can be considered an artifact sometimes. So I would like to say that in all those cases, touching the church without considering the community in a wider sense, not only the churchgoers, but the lay community or even the new communities with even other religious beliefs, but the one who dwell in those countrysides because, of course, lower prices of houses, for example. If we are able to create through the building a new sense of participation,
yeah,
buildings themselves can be restored and valorized, but also they can become a kind of tool in the end of the new society which is arising, I think, in many countries and not only here in Italy. So we have these two different aspects. Sometimes I would like to say there can be even a mistake, and the community of the closest, I mean the community of churchgoers, can be even an obstacle for a wider involvement of the community itself, because they develop a sense of property of the space, which is actually, I mean, which in contradiction with the use and with the vocation, universal vocation of the building itself. So this is just a first overview of the sense of community, which I completely agree with you. The community is a term which is, really wide, and sometimes we use the word community in a very easy way, while the community is composed by fragments.
Exactly.
Yes. And to conclude, really, sometimes, and I underline this also with students sometimes, community is an euphemistical word, because we do not have in front of us a community. We just have in front of us a society. Society, which is difficult. I mean, communities already means that you have in front of you someone who believes to share something, to have something in common with someone. But sometimes the awareness of this common thing is very feeble. And so in front of you, there is a society, and we have to clearly admit this. And so building, religious building can be an opportunity to create, or at least to create, to beginning a process to identify a community, identifying a community, at least for the building itself. They share something. So it's a way in which communities can be an ambiguous term.
That's true, and I also very agree on the possibility of seeing the dismissive church as part of a structure, as a possibility, as an occasion to somehow refresh the community, we can say. And also I agree on the need of building some sort of network around the community, because the community needs to be involved at different stages of the project. So we've seen while building new churches, but also they should be involved in the maintenance, for instance, of the spaces and in the decision-making process and so on. So it's all part of a wider network. So I don't know if you, Aldo, want to add something on the network. So in on the management strategies, on possibilities at different level of participation.
Yeah, of course. Thank you.
We have very generous.
Yeah, of course. Working with networks mean, as was said before, in the video, but also in the discussion, identifying different groups, different stakes around the building, around the values of this particular heritage. I was reading the chat of the group where Suzanne and Pilar were talking about the difference between space and place. Where space is more related with different value, intangible value and so on, not only the one added to the physical building. Quoting the cultural economist, we have to say that a cultural heritage, as a church, as many other, has different layer. In this kind of building, we can see very different kind of values. We have the spiritual values that sometimes change, modify from religious to other kind of spirituality. In that sense, we saw that communities and network recognize according to the different values. We try to subsidize, in our case, a sort of spiritual value with the creative value, a cultural value. But at the end, the attachment of the community, the attachment of the citizen and so on, is a mixture, because they perceive that going to a theater in a church is something different than going in another place as a kind of emotion. And that is maybe the difference between the place and the space they were talking on the chat.
Yeah, back on the inner value of the space. So speaking about the chat, I don't know if there is any question for our panelists, or if we shall move to the next video session and perhaps we can develop a bit further the discussion after that. Luigi, could you?
I think there are tons of,
there
is a chat of which is difficult. We should have like in many mass media, show a specific guy who take care of the chat itself, because it's difficult to have a summary of this.
No specific question for the audience.
Okay. Okay. So we can continue then to our next video session. Next video will offer us more examples on the reuse of religious heritage that address the involvement of the community at different stages of the reuse process, as we were also saying. We will start with Davide Fusari sharing his experience with Convento di Campo, where local stakeholders actively participated in defining new functions. Davide is a freelance architect. He holds a PhD in architecture and he collaborates with various seminars and design workshops on religious heritage. The video contributions will then continue with Anna Ode and Ida Charla Leumann, who were selected as one of the most interesting abstract submissions to the conference. They will present an applied cultural analysis of the use of sacred spaces carried out with Lund University. They will highlight the importance of ethnography and also cultural analysis in engaging the local communities. Remaining in Sweden, the following abstract presentation will be by Heikki Ranta. He will introduce us to the Virke method. He's the heritage officer at the Diocese of Lund, and he will speak about the tool that they developed there for supporting an extended and shared use of legally protected religious sites. Dominik Tomasov will then conclude this second session with an overview on the importance of the community in comprehension of a place, its history, its traditions. She's an architect. She obtained her degree at the University of Buenos Aires.
And in the last three decades, Dominic has developed expertise in Jewish identity, culture, and heritage as a way to contribute to the construction of pluralistic society. So once again, feel free to use the chat, add your comments, pose your questions, and enjoy this second session.
Il convento oggetto del percorso si trova a Campo Lomaso, frazione di Comano Terme in provincia di Trento. Il comune di Comano Terme fa parte delle valli giudicarie e in particolare di una porzione di questa valle costituita da una conca circondata da una corona di monti e caratterizzata da un sistema insediativo fatto di piccoli paesi sparsi nella campagna. In questo contesto il convento ha rivestito per secoli un ruolo importantissimo. È stato fondato alla metà del 600 su richiesta degli abitanti della valle che ritenevano la predicazione, l'assistenza spirituale e la formazione che i frati offrivano un importante aiuto alla loro dura vita di contadini ed ha costituito nei secoli un polo di cultura, religiosità, devozione, accoglienza e conforto anche materiale per la povera gente del territorio. Soppresso durante la parentesi napoleonica, è stato riaperto all'inizio del Novecento di nuovo grazie all'impegno della popolazione locale. Nel 2005 gli ultimi pochi frati hanno lasciato la struttura e l'ordine ha venduto il complesso all'amministrazione comunale tramite un finanziamento della provincia autonoma di Trento che ribadiva nella relativa delibera il valore sovracomunale dell'edificio e delle sue future destinazioni. La comunità, in senso ampio, esteso a tutta la valle, al di là dei campanilismi e delle singolarità dei piccoli paesi, ha dunque sempre avuto un rapporto molto stretto con il convento e la sua storia. L'area del complesso conventuale si sviluppa per circa un ettaro ed è cintata dal muro della clausura su cui si trovano i capitelli settecenteschi della Via Crucis. L'ampio spazio verde di pertinenza era una volta coltivato per soddisfare le esigenze dei frati e per aiutare la popolazione locale quando in difficoltà. L'edificio del convento vero e proprio si trova nell'angolo settentrionale del complesso ed è costituito da un impianto a C, raccolto attorno al chiostro e addossato alla chiesa, di epoca precedente al convento, spesso rimaneggiata. Tre sono i livelli per una superficie totale di circa 3.000 metri quadrati. Al piano terra, gli spazi della vita comune. Al primo piano, le abitazioni dei frati e gli spazi per lo studio individuale. Al secondo piano, aggiunto durante gli anni della soppressione, le aule per la scuola dei fratini. Dopo l'acquisizione, il convento è rimasto inutilizzato. L'amministrazione comunale ha tentato di rivalutare al suo interno alcune opzioni di riuso senza approfondirle ulteriormente. Alcune realtà del territorio hanno proposto di perseguire una strada diversa, ovvero la realizzazione di un percorso di partecipazione per coinvolgere nella definizione del futuro del convento la comunità, quella comunità che lo aveva fatto nascere e che lo aveva ristabilito quando soppresso e lo ha vissuto nei secoli. Il percorso partecipativo si è svolto tra i mesi di settembre e dicembre 2019. È stato promosso da una rete di enti che ha avuto la Fondazione Don Lorenzo Guetti, Centro Studi per la Cooperazione, come ente capofila ed è stato seguito da me e Susanna Serafini come coordinatori. Per gli aspetti metodologici siamo stati supportati da Avventura Urbana. L'obiettivo è stato quello di elaborare degli scenari di riconversione attraverso il coinvolgimento dei portatori di interesse della valle, come istituzioni, associazioni e abitanti. Un percorso di democrazia deliberativa, ovvero un confronto pubblico sugli argomenti del tema di indagine, con l'obiettivo di instaurare un confronto dialogico tra i diversi punti di vista attraverso uno scambio informato tra gli attori coinvolti. Alla base, la volontà condivisa da tutti di far parlare i valori che il convento porta con sé, grazie ai quali è stato un punto di riferimento per tutto il territorio. Valori che vanno rinnovati, con un occhio rivolto verso il futuro. Trovare nuove destinazioni, quindi, mantenendo però l'identità del luogo. Il percorso è stato sviluppato seguendo un approccio adattivo, basato sul continuo adeguamento degli strumenti metodologici alle condizioni che di volta in volta il contesto ha presentato. La struttura di base inizialmente progettata, infatti, ha subito nel corso del processo lievi modifiche e integrazioni metodologiche in relazione a sopravvenute esigenze di contesto e agli esiti delle interazioni con gli interlocutori del percorso. Data la valenza territoriale del progetto, l'elenco degli stakeholder considerati ha compreso non solo i cittadini, ma anche le istituzioni sovralocali, ovvero altri soggetti che, pur esterni al territorio, potevano apportare contributi interessanti. Inoltre, il percorso è stato pensato come un processo itinerante in cui ogni incontro è stato programmato in un comune diverso della valle. Questo è stato finalizzato a contribuire a portare fuori il convento dal territorio comunale in cui risiede e a favorire una visione di valle sul tema della sua riqualificazione. Tre sono state le fasi del percorso. La prima fase, di ascolto e condivisione, ha visto abitanti e amministrazioni coinvolti in incontri aperti, interviste, sopralluoghi e altri eventi. La seconda fase è stata costituita da un evento di approfondimento aperto al pubblico, svolto con la modalità del town meeting. La terza fase, di elaborazione delle strategie progettuali, ha permesso di fare sintesi di quanto emerso, declinando progettualmente le ipotesi. Dal percorso sono emersi molteplici scenari offerti all'approfondimento delle amministrazioni. Alla base, numerosi aspetti comuni, come la volontà di preservare i valori che hanno animato il convento, la multifunzionalità, la volontà di realizzare una struttura che si autosostenti e che possa contribuire al futuro sociale e culturale della valle. In particolare, la fase progettuale ha messo in luce la necessità di partire subito con una fase zero che, attraverso una riattivazione temporanea delle parti utilizzabili con pochi o nessun intervento, permetta alla comunità di rientrare nel convento riappropriandosene. Più di 340 sono state le persone coinvolte nel percorso durato circa 3 mesi, un percorso diverso da quello a cui la valle e le sue amministrazioni sono abituate. Le decisioni solitamente vengono prese dall'alto e c'è pregiudizio verso questo tipo di strumenti. Una nuova consapevolezza e nuove competenze potranno aiutare a cambiare una situazione che tuttavia deve fare i conti con la scarsa densità culturale, economica e umana di una valle alpina come la nostra. Ci stiamo impegnando a proseguire l'iniziativa. Nonostante lo stop imposto dal Covid-19, l'amministrazione comunale di Comano Terme intende dare seguito agli esiti del processo. Per l'estate 2021 il convento è stato aperto alla comunità e ai turisti. I suoi spazi al piano terra sono sede di una mostra temporanea allestita dal Parco Naturale Adamello Brenta e il cortile retrostante, arricchito da una installazione in legno realizzata dal collettivo Camposaz, è teatro di eventi e attività. L'obiettivo della riattivazione temporanea degli spazi utilizzabili così come sono, sgomberati e puliti insieme alla comunità e minimamente messi a norma, è stato raggiunto e siamo già alle prese con la programmazione 2022. Parallelamente stiamo lavorando alla strategia generale di riuso. Il percorso partecipativo è stato una base importante e direi imprescindibile per concentrare l'attenzione della comunità a tutti i livelli sul tema. Per proseguire mantenendo lo spirito iniziale bisogna farsi spazio tra le complicazioni che quotidianamente occupano le attenzioni degli stakeholder. Questo non è facile e la comunità degli abitanti da sola non basta. La cosa importante sarà il consolidamento della rete, la definizione dei protocolli di relazione tra i suoi membri e la definizione di un programma concreto e sostenibile sulla base del quale proseguire. Vi ringrazio per l'invito a questo convegno e spero di potervi raccontare presto nuovi aggiornamenti su questa esperienza. Grazie.
Hey everyone, my name is Ida And my name is Anna. We are students of Masters in Applied Culture Analysis at Lund University. Last year, we did a project with the Church of Sweden, and we looked into the changing use of space in church buildings. We focused on Oderslövs Church, which is a deconsecrated church in Torn Parish outside of Lund, and which currently hosts an art exhibition. Our aim was to find possibilities for future use in line with the wishes of the local community. So first, we want to explain what a culture analyst does. So for instance, we investigate human values and habits and how these affect the everyday life of a particular group. Culture analysis builds on ethnographic methods such as observation, interview and photo. So ethnography is basically about getting to know communities. We combine these ethnographic methods with social theories to produce knowledge. And then we create recommendations that are tailored for the client and possible to implement in practice.
Yeah, so first thing we did during our fieldwork was to map the community and the current and the new potential users of the church space in Torn Parish. And then we reached out to people from all of these different groups to figure out what meanings they attach to the church, both church buildings and the Swedish church as an institution. And what we found was that for many people, the Church of Oderslev still held meaning, even if they do not use the space, even if they do not go to the art exhibition there. And it doesn't really matter that the church is deconsecrated, because what was important to the persons we spoke to was the history of the building and the fact that it has been the center of events for so many people from the community before them. We also found another interesting point is that Oderslev is actually located in this borderland between town and countryside. It is arguably in the countryside, but because this ESS science village is being built on the outskirts of Lund, the town is actually expanding quite far into the area of the church, which again creates a very mixed community of the old residents and all of the new people who are already moving to the area. And we saw the church as a potential meeting point and bridge, so to speak, between the old and the new community that is there. When we presented our findings to our client, we also played with the idea of Oderslev Church as a lighthouse, because one of our clients described the church as such when we interviewed her. And because, like a lighthouse, it is a place that can gather different groups of people for art exhibitions, for potential other activities, as Anna will touch upon. But all of our recommendations for our clients were about continuing to use the church as a meeting space.
So our first suggestion was to build on the current use of the church as a space of art. The idea of the church as an exhibition space appealed to people across ages and different ages and interests. The main thing was just to promote it more and to develop it more. Many people were unaware of the art exhibition, and we think that there could have been more community engagement with this particular use. Our second suggestion was more of a long-term idea. We saw potential for creating an interfaith meeting place as the ESS Science Village is under construction nearby. This will be an international workplace for people with various backgrounds. However, this suggestion requires more resources in form, in terms of renovation, and of course that the future employees of ESS are interested. This also emphasizes the importance of dialogue with the local community in heritage conservation. This idea was in line with the local congregation's values because they said that they wanted the Swedish church to be a meeting place.
Yeah, we hope that our presentation has encouraged you to consider the value of ethnography and cultural analysis in terms of engaging old and new communities around a certain space. The methods are rooted in the particular community in question and produce rich insights from that place. Furthermore, our educational background also gives us a theoretical lens that can put a new perspective on something familiar and enable us to act as a matchmaker between community and space. Thank you for listening. If any of you have questions or thoughts, please don't hesitate to contact any of us. And yeah, thanks for listening again. And thank you, FRH, for giving us the opportunity to present.
Thank you so much.
My name is Heikki Ranta. I work and live in Sweden, in the southern part of Sweden, and I work in the Evangelical Lutheran Church of Sweden as a heritage officer in the Diocese of Lund. And the Diocese of Lund is the southernmost of all the 13 dioceses of Sweden. Historically, we have been a part of Denmark, and also, of course, as a sovereign Swedish country. And that means that our ecclesiastical traditions are pretty common to the Danish, German, and European traditions. What I'm going to tell you now about is our method called Virket. And the purpose of this method Virket is to support our parishes and other stakeholders who work on the development of legally protected church buildings and church sites so that they can be preserved, used, and developed in the future. Virket should therefore be helpful to all those who work with, for example, property facilities planning, parish instructions and conservation and maintenance planning. And Virket should also be useful when you investigate alternative uses of church buildings prior to any kind of decisions of any kind of alterations, refurnishings of the church buildings belonging to the Church of Sweden. This is how the chart or the matrix looks like. It is a pretty horrible picture consisting of several small boxes with many words within every box, but it is actually a roadmap for parish and diocese use. It is to be seen as a discussion leader. It should be, believe or not, even inspirational. Its purpose is to widen our views and understandings when it comes to the church buildings and the ecclesiastical heritage. The method was created in cooperation with the Churches Conservation Trust in England and with Church of Sweden and the Diocese of Lund. The cooperation started actually within the framework of FRH already 2014, and especially the program Alter Heritage was very important because that's the program that was the framework where we met Churches Conservation Trust for the first time. The title of the method, it is Virket, that means timber in Swedish language. It also is a name of a specific church building here in the Diocese of Lund, a church building that has been some kind of a pilot subject or object when developing the method. Virket, it is a method to preserve, use, and develop ecclesiastical heritage in Diocese of Lund. Those words, preserve, use, and develop, those are very important in Sweden and in the cultural politics of the country. They actually come from the documents taken by the Parliament of Sweden. So we are talking about very important, heavy words in when we are talking about the ecclesiastical heritage. Preserve, use, and develop. The goals of the method are pretty simple. Ecclesiastical heritage is preserved, used, and developed. That is the goal, number one. The second goal is that ecclesiastical heritage, it will strengthen and reinforce parish life. Administration and management of the heritage in local organizations becomes efficient and sustainable. And finally, ecclesiastical heritage is a commitment and resource for the for our communities and the whole society outside the parish and the church life. The red boxes on the line high up of the chart, that are the six different themes or areas we have been concentrated on when creating the method. The themes are ecclesiastical heritage, the worship, of course, individuals, community cooperations, sustainability, and finally administration and management. All these areas and themes are to be discussed separately and together in a process that looks like this. The horizontal lines, they show how the process is to be done through. Of course, you always start with an identification of the current situation and the problem. Then you go further to analyze the problems, the issues. You try to process them in order to come to decisions that stake out the way to outcome, which is the final phase of the five different processing phases that we have in this method. For example, I can't actually go into all these areas, the six different themes in detail, but we have thought every theme through from the very beginning to come to the outcome and decisions. And of course, different areas need different kind of competencies. It is a question of different issues, different problems. Expertise of different kind is needed, engineers, architects, but also the heritage professionals and people who know much about climate and sustainability, etc., etc. The co-workers of the parish are key persons, so are the volunteers and the members of the parishes. One of the themes is the final theme here. It is the administration and management. It is very important to identify and see what the current situation is, how the administration and management is created today, and what competencies, resources are needed for a multifunctional and flexible use of the future use of the churches, of the ecclesiastical heritage. It is question about long-term planning and resources, business planning and funding. And one important thing question is, of course, the accessibility to the heritage and to the church buildings and church sites. Volunteers, partners, cooperations are very important when creating a future administration and management of the ecclesiastical heritage, because the professionals and the finances of the parishes are very limited. The idea, the outcome, the goal is to see how to find a long-term and sustainable solutions when administrating and manage the church buildings, the ecclesiastical heritage. This is what I really wanted to tell you, to introduce to the
Virket method. I hope you get interested. And if you do it, please don't hesitate to contact me in Sweden. Thank you.
Belonging to a congregation in Barcelona sparked my interest in local Jewish history, which turned into a way to connect to this country. As an architect, I do research and I am an activist to dignify and signify our heritage. Let me suggest that human creations are inspired by a soul peculiar to each cultural group. A heritage recovery project should allow that soul to shine with all its splendor. This will only be possible if the group that created it contributes to the interpretation of the site. The cemeteries deal with very sensitive ideas, life and death. Thus, my interest in cemeteries is not archaeological, but in that intangible dimension. The earliest documented news of Jews in Barcelona refer us to the 9th century. And they are, a couple of them are about the cemetery, which was on a hill called Montjuïc, Mount of the Jews. The oldest archival mentions are to the cemetery. A cemetery speaks of a community, as the first obligation is to bury and respect until the end of time. The Jewish community did not recover from the anti-Jewish attacks throughout Spain in 1391. The cemetery reverts to the crown and then passes on to new owners who sell the majority of the tombstones for construction. Despite this, the site never ceased to serve its function as people continued buried there. But the Jewish community lost their connection. Their tradition of visiting and preserving the graves was suddenly interrupted. Their active memory was broken. In the early 1900s, all the extension of Montjuïc will become municipal property, starting a process that brought it to be our central park today. The cemetery, which remained underground, was affected by development, which uncovered graves and some tombstones in different locations. In 1946, a shooting club in the 60s, an amusement park, later replaced by beautiful gardens. In all cases, there was no mention to Jewish memory nor respect to the graves. The Museum of History keeps about 30 full pieces or fragments of tombstones, a few of them on display. As most buildings have been replaced since, we can see very few of the fragments in construction. For example, these on a wall by the cathedral. In 2006, there was another fragment of the cemetery, this oval in white, that would be landscaped, still with no reference to the Jewish relationship. Together with a colleague, we promoted a petition to the Catalan government to designate it as a cultural site of national interest. The campaign was endorsed by the Jewish communities and the cultural entity of Barcelona. We then created Center of Studies Sahor, active through 2012, to raise awareness about the value of the site and to find more accurate information regarding its extension. We refer to all cartography and property deeds going back to the 1300s. Site was designated as a landmark site in 2009, but there's still pending proper intervention. Same year, cemeteries were found in some Spanish cities, and we moved heaven and earth asking for an alternative for excavations. As a result, the Spanish government signed a protocol with the Federation of Jewish Communities by which they are to be notified of these findings. Center Sahor also edited a book to give information to the public about our funerary tradition. It is the only publication of this kind in Spain. The plot pending action can be seen from this terrace where people come to enjoy a spectacular view over the city. What lies below is part of our cemetery, but there is no way to know. The first move to protect the site for its inherent meaning came from the Jewish community. In an effort to rebuild our connection with the site, I started organizing days of memory when we need to ask to be open the site, which is otherwise closed to public. My regular visits to talk about its history and essence are of great interest.
the larger community, that is the residents in town and part of the public officers, understand that this piece must be recovered as a resource. Together with SOS Monuments, an organization dedicated to heritage protection, we have requested signage that is being prepared by the Museum of History. At this point, there is no political intention to deal with this project. We must continue raising interest among the general public and building dialogue between the Jewish community and the authorities. We look forward to a sensitive project, which will count with the cooperation of the Jewish community. All Jewish cemeteries are home for eternity and should be respected with the same criteria with which they were created. Ancestors of all Sephardi Jews in the world are buried in the Iberian Peninsula. 90% of approximately 100 Jewish ancient cemeteries in Spain have not been identified yet. They should be reserved to build a diverse collective memory for culture and education, and without a doubt, to help Jews reconnect with the place. We are building plural societies across Europe. We owe it to ourselves and to the generations to come.
Okay, so thanks once again to the video contributors. And in case you are interested in other abstracts that were submitted to the conference, then you can find them at the FRH website. Now, looking back at our panelists, we have heard about some tools and instruments that can support the decision-making process and also the, let's say, the management of religious heritage. And trying to combine tools and community, I would like to ask Antonia, what do you think that could be like useful tools for the community engagement? And is there some way to value it and to verify it?
Yeah, so I've heard this discussion with a lot of interest, starting from the idea of a community as not an homogeneous organism, let's say, so this heterogeneous mix of different thoughts, different ideas, different interests. So let's say that we start with the community with a sum of particles, okay? So the community should be built, as also Luigi was saying before. Is not done, it is a kind of an achievement, something that comes after. So we become a community after some time, after some interaction. So it comes also to the idea of cultural heritage and especially religious heritage as an ecosystem, as a sum, but also a sum of elements, but also of relationships. So starting from this idea, that is an idea of evolutionary process, of a dynamic process, a community that is not done, but it is also not always the same, it changes over time. Then I would highlight the way in which this community building can be supported and the instruments, the tool that you were mentioning. We have seen some examples here in the videos. I can refer to Alessandro Bellini and Valerio Pennasso laboratories they have presented, but also the Virket tool that has been presented in from Sweden. So these are all tools that are based on analysis, on understanding the different points of views, the different values that are led to the from the different parts of the communities. So here, the cultural heritage and especially the religious heritage can become an element of connection between the different parts. So cultural heritage has this particular meaning, particular value layered over time that was recognized in the past as it is maintained and remained in the urban layer, in the urban structure over time, over centuries, millennia sometimes. So it is an element that is that has been recognized recognized over time, but also recognized today, let's say, and it can become the element that is connecting people together. Based on what? Based on of an expression of identity, of diversity, of cultural historic meanings, sense. So it creates, it can create potentially a sense of community between people. So all these tools that are related to understanding the views, understanding the different interests, the questionnaires, the data collection analysis, and all this helps to connect and to generate a dialogue and a common understanding. So I'm working on in the CNR as a researcher on the evaluation tools, evaluation aspects, and all this starts from values. So which are the values that are recognized, that can be recognized, which are the conflicting values, but also the connecting values, and understanding all this can generate, let's say, trigger a discussion and a process of, we can say, of democracy. It's a laboratory of democracy, of community building, when we want to reuse, for example, a site that is completely abandoned or has a potential that has not been exploited in the past. I would stress this capacity of evaluation, co-evaluation, and discussion, trying to estimate which could be the outcomes, the impacts of different alternatives of reuse, different uses, and try to discuss and build the most satisfying solution. So we are talking about the most satisfying solution, not the best one, but the one that can, after a process, can be identified as the most satisfying one in an evolutionary perspective, something that is not in stone, written in stone, but can always change and can always become better, let's say. So yeah, so I would like to stress the evaluation tool, the evaluation capacity, as one of the key aspects also needed to build these communities and to support the evolution of the communities over time, especially, last point, then I close, especially in this time of rapid, very rapid evolution. So in which, let's say, every month, every day, something changes, and to have the capacity to collaborate, to exchange, to maintain an open dialogue with the other parts of this large community is key to address the challenges of a future that will be more and more rapid and in evolution. We don't hear you.
Teresa, perhaps you want to add up on that?
Yes, Antonio focused more on the evaluation aspect and the how you evaluate the impact of those participatory processes that we saw take a huge part on the regeneration of religious heritage. And I was by listening to the video and to the project presented, I was thinking about how they develop those projects according to a circle. You know, that's a circle that it's important to be this recursive dynamic, which is from one side, and let's say we can start with the build a community, as has been already said, and understand the potential and the resources of community, and the potential within the community, what they identify themselves, how do they identify themselves in a place, what is what are the meanings that they give to the specific place, and how they can contribute in make them that space part of their, let's say, life and set of spaces that they are going to use or give meaning to those spaces. And it's extremely important by building a community to listen to the community. And the project and some of the project presented specifically focus on that, in the perception of people involved, in the value, as Antonia said, the value, you know, that those are the core aspect in which you have to start developing a regenerative process and vision that they have about the specific place. And I think I once attended a conference, and one of the panelists said, people participate because people can, when people can imagine, when they have power over, like when they have imaginative power. And I think that it's, that I saw that that imaginative power and willingness to be involved and to participate in that, in some of the projects that were proposed. And I think, and last but not least, because I consider that as a circle, so the following step will be the actual creation of the output of this participatory process, because we see a lot of them are coordinated by consultant, like technical consultant, and they need methodology, because as Antonia said, there is a methodology to project and implement those participatory process. But we see this coordination and methodologist, let's say, cannot have a immense power over the process. And it's important, for example, in these cases, to observe a co-creative approach, meaning all the competencies and the knowledge and the value and the visions and the perspective and the competencies and the capabilities should be part of this process, with this participatory process. And by that you can reach the great success that those projects presented reached. And I think that's the big challenge of participatory processes. That's the real deal, let's say, because you have to put together different interests and power, different competencies and knowledge. But once you manage to do so, once you methodologically manage to do so, and you are allowed and you are capable of creating these participatory processes, you see that they have a huge impact. And when you're going to evaluate that impact, you see that the shift, the change that they produced, it's bigger, it's more important, it's more rooted in the specific area in which those spaces, like religious spaces, are situated. So I'm glad to see that there are a lot of experience, that participatory experience regarding that, and I think that is the real the future, basically, for creating a community and reinforce community and reinforce the shared meaning of those places among communities.
Yeah. Yes, I agree. And both you and Antonia, you recall these values, these inner values, these meanings that religious heritage holds. So they recall, I would say, rituals, memories, and so they really collect somehow the sense of belonging that we are talking about. So, and I think that this participatory process, as we have also seen during the videos, they somehow converge to adaptive reuse strategies. So I was wondering if Aldo, you want to give us your impression based on your experience about adaptive reuse?
Yes, I was reading the comments and the meaning of the meaning of participatory and recognition of community into decision making. In reuse, our practice is not about decision making, is much more about catching an evolution and designing an evolution with a group of people. I think that as we consider religious heritage as something static, of course you have stages and in different stages to decide what to do. In our practice, in our methodology, it's much more fluid and dynamic, the conception and the use. So it's an evolution and it's not decided by a committee, by something that, as they were just saying, risks to become an echo chamber, and it's a good choice, is a good observation, is an evolution of something. In our case, that building shows an evolution that was not decided. It's a fluid process that passes and adapts itself to the different layer of society, to the different uses of society of that building. Society change, and as we were saying, also the organization of society change. The Virken model put a word that is very, very fashionable, and so far we have never said, but I have to say this, about sustainability. I think that here we are talking a lot about the social sustainability and what the relation between the people and the building define as sustainable for a span of time. Mm-hmm. No, and then it will change, and then it will change, and then it will change. Now for us, the sustainability, the social sustainability means taking care of fragility, of the time we are living, that is exposing us to risk, a lot of risk, something that we were not very happy to, and to the concept of weaknesses that we were forgetting somehow. In that sense, some values of a church come back, no? Because it's again a building taking care about weakness, about the fragile, and so on. So it's not decided, it's a kind of evolution, and you have to just catch and understand what is going on and to adapt as a manager, to take the responsibility, of course, to adapt the use of that building to the fluence and to the change of our society, considering the constraint you have in managing a building that sometimes is 100 years old and so needs respect and conservation.
Luigi, yeah. Where do you think this evolution is going? So how do you foresee the future of the religious heritage?
May I ask for another question? I mean, it's a bit difficult. No, I'm not able to answer this question because it's really too deep. Nevertheless, I would try to hazard an overview on the future. But I would like also to reestablish, reformulate a question from the audience we have seen just before the Jordi reported. Is and I reformulate. And I reformulate it this way: which is the role of the space in shaping a community? Which is the role of the space in helping the construction of participatory process? I think that our heritage as a general great power in creating and shaping community. And because it's a condensator of memories. We have rediscovered it in Lucca, reporting a case of study that Davide Di Modugno mentioned in his presentation, with the exposition coordinated by Elena Franco and me on the threshold of lost words, sulla soglia di mondi perduti, where a few pictures of this former monastery were displaced inside the space of the monastery itself. And we had a discreet, wide number of people who came and see the exhibition. I mean, 250 in 2 weekends, 300 people. And all these people were somehow connected with the space. That is, they have heard narration by the aunt or some other and a cousin inside the nun, etc. So, I mean, buildings are collector of memories. This is general, I mean, this is general. But specifically, and this I would like to point out a few things. The first thing is relating to church. Of course, church are places where the participation creates the worship. I mean, it's not a poetic vision. Sometimes we are attacked by the fact that we architects, we see something metaphorical in everything, a bit detached from real values and meanings inside space. Instead, churches were built to create a participation, a so high participation that create a ritual. The ritual is a matter of participation. But if you want, and so this is against the fact that we are not poetics, we are real and close to reality. And sometimes the reality is also a matter of meanings, a matter of symbols, because of course, we have almost lost this ability to look into symbols or to live, or even more, to living symbolically. We have almost lost this capacity. But by the way, churches were exactly this, to create only one body of different people. In real, by means of a worship. This is first point. The second point is, I think, a translation in the sense of also of traditio, tradere, that is to transmit, like an heritage indeed, no? You leave something in the others of someone else in a translation of values, because also in this point of view we cannot avoid a realistic approach, that is that building built in a clear theological environment and also according to some theological values are now translated, or they have to be carried into our secularized era. So among the values on which they were built, we have to select those on which we can create a kind of society able to recognize them, it's very difficult to have, a community which take into account the theological values
on which or for which a convent or a monastic place was built, of several values. To be realistic, we have to create space for museums or for musealization, spaces for memories. But of other values that especially convent and monasteries are shaped upon can be considered again to create a new condensator for democracy, new places for building democracy, to build democracy. In this case, for example, think about the fact that these buildings are always enormous, 3,000 square meters. Of course, it's difficult to think a valorization made by only one actor, only one stakeholder. We have to think always communities of stakeholders. And in this sense, we can revitalize, we can relaunch somehow, reshape the capitular hall, la sala capitolare, where also in the past decisions were taken. And so we cannot only create a place fixed in a destination. We can create a place which live with the community of communities, which the place hosts, having a place which is still used to take decision, like it would be a boat. And they have to decide where the boat has to be directed. So in my opinion, convents, especially convents and monasteries, are places to create a place for democracy, a lab, a city lab of democracy and common decision making. So in this sense, not only we have to create a process to decide the destination of the place, but the place can be an opportunity to create this. So,
some sort of co-evolution.
Exactly. I don't know if I expressed
this. Yeah, unfortunately, we are coming though to the end of the event. So I would introduce the last item. And this is Jordi Malarac from FRH. He's presently developed FRH Inform Factsheets. It's a project that researches the state of religious heritage sites on a Europe-wide scale. So please, Jordi, go ahead.
Dear conference participants, I would like to present to you the FRH Inform project. This project has been ongoing for 3 years at FRH and has brought together the information on the state of religious heritage in Europe. We currently have 30 fact sheets from EU member states, North Macedonia, Norway, and the UK, all of which we have FRH members in these countries, which were very helpful in providing information. We also have a very helpful academic team, researchers from across Europe that have helped us review and compile this information, which we can now present to you. These fact sheets include background information of each country on the general state of religious heritage, the number and typology of building based on religious denomination and other typologies, the amount of listed buildings and those that are protected by some public authority, the ownership of the buildings, which varies depending on the country, and the financing and management of the buildings, as well as specific threats that each country is facing, general threats, but also specific to a country, and easy to compare infographics. In this example, you can see how the fact sheets are structured. They include all this information in a very summarized way. They also include all the sources where we obtain this information, so you for continued reading or more in-depth analysis. The category that shifts the most, that varies the most between fact sheets, is the threats to the sector. You all know that there's some overarching threats: the disuse of religious heritage sites, increased urbanization, which has left some rural sites redundant, also changing demographics. But there's also more country-specific threats that we outline in these fact sheets. And there's country-specific infographics as well. They all include the sites by denomination and the number of listed sites, but they also include some specific examples in each country that we wanted to highlight. So these fact sheets are now available on the website. You can visit them here, and we encourage you to do so. I'm sure you will find something interesting in these fact sheets. And the launch, the official launch, will be on Monday, 27th of September, so next Monday, which we'll share with the general public and with the European institutions, who will no doubt be interested in learning about what is the state of religious heritage in Europe. So these fact sheets now offer easy to compare information on all the different European countries. Of course, this was done with the objective of overcoming the current limitations of fragmented data, which is spread across national, regional, and private databases. And this was just a first step, as the objective of this project is to continue FRH Inform into the future and to develop the European Religious Heritage Database. This European Religious Heritage Database aims to not only determine the state of religious heritage sites in Europe, as these fact sheets aim to do, but also to analyze the renewable energy usage in religious heritage buildings, the biodiversity in lands owned by religious heritage sites, the sites that have been given an adaptive reuse or a new use, burial sites, archives focusing on religious heritage, and more. This we aim to do with FRH partners, with academic partners from different academic institutions that are members or collaborators of FRH, as well as with digital heritage specialists. So we look forward to inviting all of you to participate in this next phase of our FRH Inform project, the European Religious Heritage Database, and providing the general public and policymakers with up-to-date information on what the state is of religious heritage in Europe, which, having this information, allows you to then analyze it and find solutions to the current problems we're facing. Thank you very much, and I hope you enjoyed today's conference event. Thank you.
Okay, so we came to the conclusion of the afternoon together of this hybrid event. I would like to thank everyone who participated. So thanks to the audience, you stayed with us and you shared the comments, you shared your reflections, and that was extremely interesting. Thank you to the video contributors who brought their experience and the examples. And also thanks to our live panelists, to Antonia who connected to give life to this discussion. And also thanks to the FRH team for the technical support here in Bologna. And also thanks to all those who worked for this event to make it possible. I think that our discussion clearly showed that the need to integrate various stakeholders to promote the dialogue and to develop actoral collaboration of several subjects towards a living religious heritage. And that would thus respond to the needs of the evolving society, yet, let's say, valuing the history of the place and the history of the community. So once again, thank you all. See you at the next FRH event. Thanks once again, and ciao, I would say.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Goodbye.